next Saturday, of course, is going to be the fundraiser, the spaghetti dinner. What time does it start? 4 o'clock, okay. And all of the bake sale and everything going to be going on here. So that's for little David, okay? That's for little David. Praise the Lord. Chili and chili dogs also. Okay. Praise God. That's good. Amen. Praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
Turn the Bible to chapter 3 of Genesis. Genesis chapter 3. Praise God. You know, the Bible tells us in the word of the Lord, for the word of the Lord, he said, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season, and reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come, it probably is right now, when men will not endure sound doctrine, but heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. They'll turn their ears from the truth and be turned unto fables, fairy tales, non-scriptural stories, and which will then give them no power, no spiritual fortitude to stand up against the wiles of the devil. Now Satan come to kill, steal, and destroy, but Jesus said, I've come to give you life and give it to you more abundantly.
Glory, yes.
And so there's a message that's stirring in my spirit. Reverse the curse.
Glory.
I think for so long we thought, well, we just got to live under the curse of sin.
Amen.
But, you know, it just, you know, it happened, and in the garden they failed, and we're all fallen humans, and so we just got to learn how to live under the curse.
No.
We're the curse breakers, that's right. Because Jesus Christ broke the curse. Amen. He reversed the curse. Now, the curse of sin, of course, came when they sinned in the garden. So let's just go right now to Genesis 3. We'll read a little bit here. It says, now the serpent was more subtle, or more crafty, or more sly, more clever, it could have said, than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? The woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. So Satan, first of all, tested if she knew the commandment.
Yes, amen.
He said, is it okay to eat everything in the garden? She said, it's okay to eat everything in the garden, except we can't even look at that tree. We can't touch that tree. We can't eat it. So he was testing, first thing, does she know the word?
That's right.
The first thing the devil does when he comes to you is find out just how spiritually strong you are. If he's going to fight you, he's got to figure out where your weakness is. And if you don't have the word of the Lord, if you're not reading it, if you're not applying it, if you're not hearing it, if you're not believing it, if you're not confessing it, then he has an easier time to attack you. He can deceive you.
Amen.
But if you know the word,
yes,
then every time he comes, to hold it a minute.
Glory.
Remember what Jesus did? The Bible says that Lucifer came to him and said, why don't you turn these stones into bread? You've been fasting and praying for 40 days in the wilderness. And Jesus said, for it is written, man can't live by bread alone, but for every word that proceeded from the mouth of God.
Glory.
I mean, so Jesus didn't want to get into a theological debate with the devil. He wasn't going to sit and argue with him and rationalize it and think it over. He said, well, you know, you got a point there. I'm kind of hungry. You know, maybe it would be okay if I went ahead and just obeyed your voice and just turned these stones to bread. But see, Jesus knew that he was not going to answer one, not one time was he going to allow Satan to dictate his destiny.
Amen. Yes. Hallelujah.
Satan is not in charge of your life.
Praise God. Richard.
Yay. Glory.
Glory.
You have the power in the name of Jesus. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
This week I was very privileged. I was invited. The reason I went to Tennessee is I was invited by the Billy Graham Crusade to come and have to be a part of a prayer breakfast, the Billy Graham breakfast. There was a big convention anyway, and I got to meet several different people, including Alec Baldwin. You may know the actor. You guys know Alec Baldwin. Well, I met his brother, Stephen Baldwin, who's a good God-fearing Christian, preached a little.
Praise God.
And Jonathan Cahn, and there was several other really good men and women of God there. But the Billy Graham organization invited Heidi and I for breakfast, so we went. And we had already accepted this invitation before Billy Graham died. And Will Graham was supposed to preach at the breakfast, and that's the grandson of Billy Graham, and he's an evangelist.
Praise
Powerful
God,
evangelist.
Hallelujah.
But he couldn't be there because, of course, Billy Graham died, and so the whole family was in Washington, then going to North Carolina for the funeral. So we went to the breakfast. There was about 150 people who had received the invitation.
Praise God.
We had a good breakfast, and we met with the Billy Graham staff, and they were very wonderful people. And then they said, we're sorry that Will Graham can't be here, but we have something for you. We have a movie that's going to air tonight on Fox, all the Fox channels. Not Fox News, but on the regular Fox affiliates. We have a movie of the life of Billy Graham. Fox has just approved to show it tonight, Sunday night. It's never been seen before. And we're going to show it this morning at the breakfast to you. First 150 people to see it. So they play the movie.
Praise God.
And I don't cry. I mean, it takes a lot to make me cry. I mean, just kind of holding back. I can hold back them tears. But I broke down 4 or 5 times in this movie. It is one of the most powerful films I've ever seen.
Amen.
You see Billy Graham preaching in different crusades over the span of his life and thousands of people. You see altar calls he gives.
Amen.
His mother speaks. His wife. His children. It's just an incredible story of his life and the Word of God and how he had to go in and counsel 12 different presidents, and how he every time he went in, no matter who he was talking to, he had the same message:
Amen.
You must be born again.
Praise God.
You got to be right with God. You got to repent. Life to Jesus Christ. And so, you know, he just had the same message. It was the same message.
Yes.
He had nothing fancy. It just get right, live right, and die right.
Hallelujah.
It's the only way you can make it. Praise God.
Amen. Yes.
And there was something about this simple message that all of a sudden now the world begins to realize when the dust settles at the end of the day, that really nothing else is going to matter except are you right with the Lord?
Amen.
And so even with Billy Graham's funeral, and even with the movie that will tonight, and I will make a prediction. I don't know how many people will get saved, but I will guarantee to you, people will be saved tonight all across America. They will. There's no way they'll sit through this film. There will be people sitting there, they'll fall on their knees and get saved tonight. I'm going to say it right now. Because you can't stop the Spirit of God. It's quick, it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. It is the power of God, the Bible says.
Amen.
For we kept by the word of our testimony and the blood of the Lamb. And the power of God, it says, the Bible says, when you put on that whole armor of God, you're wearing that helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, your feet are shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You have the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praise the Lord. Your loins have been girded with truth. Praise the Lord. And then you've got a shield of faith that fights off all the fiery darts of the wicked. I'm telling you, if God be for you, who can be against you?
Amen.
Reverse the curse. So she says, wait a minute, we can't eat of this one tree. And the Bible says, the serpent said to the woman, ye shall not surely die. There's one of the biggest lies ever told.
Amen. Preach it.
But he is the author of lies. For the God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise. And she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also to her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together, and they made themselves aprons or a covering. And they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. They tried to cover up their sin with the trees, the fig trees and the leaves that they weren't allowed to have. They even tried to hide from him among the trees that they were allowed to be among. Some folks want to hide their sin in the midst of the blessing.
Preach it.
You know, you try to cover it up. Try to be, it's okay, you know. I'm just going to sit here quietly and not say anything. And maybe everything will work out. Except you repent, you shall all likewise perish.
Yes.
The only way to have the curse of sin reversed in your life is to come to the Lord Jesus Christ.
Glory.
To be born again of the water of the Spirit of God. To come to life's flowing fountain and have a drink of the living water. To be born again, praise God. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews and came to Jesus by night. He said, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher for God. For God cannot, no man can do these miracles except God be with him. But Jesus' response was, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah, yes.
Reverse the curse. And so the Bible says, and they hid among the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden. I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And he said, but who told thee that thou was naked? Who gave you this revelation? Well, I never said anything about you. I blessed you. I put you in this garden. I told you you were in the presence of the Lord. I told you you could eat anything was here. I only gave you one simple commandment. And unless you have done something wrong, you couldn't be naked. Praise God.
Amen.
And you know the Bible says, be sure your sin will find you out.
Yes,
and the soul that sins shall surely die. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's Romans 6:23. And so there's no question. There's no doubt about it. God starts figuring this out. And he said, who told thee thou was naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, the woman. Okay? It's not my fault, God. You gave me this woman. And she has led me astray. Wait a minute, Adam. You were the one that said you wanted to help me. Am I right?
Man, yeah.
You cried and whined and said, look at all the animals in the field. They all have a help me. And I'm sitting here by myself. Don't be going there now, Adam. Don't be blaming your wife for everything that goes wrong.
That's right.
Amen. Men, take accountability for your own, for the family and for your own life.
Amen.
For your own home. That's a good place to say amen.
Amen. Amen.
And so accountability was important. God wanted to be sure that Adam understood his accountability.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So before you can ever get your sin cleansed, you got to first recognize you got sin.
Yes. Amen.
And you know, David said when he took the Bathsheba, the Uriah, the Hittite's wife, when he sent him to battle, put him out on the front line and made sure he got out in the worst place so he could be killed, so that he could then take his wife. Praise the Lord. Why? Because he was trying to cover the sin of adultery that he had already committed when he had taken the woman that was not his. But you see, you can't cover this thing up because God's got a prophet somewhere who will speak to him and say, go to him and say, David, you're the man. And so when Nathan preached to him, he said, you're the man. Be sure your sin will find you out. In other words, we've all sinned, folks, and come short of the glory of God.
Yes.
There's none of us righteous, not one.
Amen.
And God will bring our sin before us if we commit it.
Yes.
Amen. And thank God for the grace of God that we can get forgiveness. Amen.
Amen.
We don't preach judgment, people. We do lead people to the cross. That's the only place you can get the curse reversed.
Amen.
Now, as a Christian, you will even have the devil attack you and try to put the curse on you.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of curses in the Bible. You can read them in Deuteronomy. It'll tell you there's 14 blessings if you keep the laws of God. And there's about 58 curses. So, I mean, it's kind of bad. When I start reading Deuteronomy 28, I love the first 14 or 15 verses. But then when I read the rest, it's like, Lord, have mercy. But maybe that is to help me to understand the consequences of sin.
Yes, amen.
You know, so there is a consequence for sin. So there is a price to be paid. And so let's read on what it says here. The Bible said, who told you were naked? And the man said, the woman whom thou gavest to me to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. And the Lord said unto the woman, what is this thou hast done? And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat. Everybody's got an excuse. Everybody's got to blame somebody else. I would have done right if it just weren't for him.
Amen.
I could have been better if they just didn't bother me. I wouldn't have lost my temper like that. I usually don't fly off the handle like that. If they just left me alone, that's not going to cut it.
No, it's not.
Okay. So we got to get things right. We got to get rooted and grounded in the Word.
Yes.
Jesus was like a lamb led to the slaughter, and he opened not his mouth.
Amen.
He was like was dumb and brought before the shears, yet he opened not his mouth. He was esteemed, he was stricken and smitten of God, a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. He was acquainted with grief even. Listen, he had no beauty that we should desire. And we took him to the cross, and he died on the cross for the sin of humanity. And we put upon him the iniquity of us all.
Yes.
So they were blaming each other and the devil in the garden. But that won't solve the problem. And so at the end of the day, accountability is required by God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen.
And so here's what the scripture says. And the Lord though said. And the Lord God said unto the serpent. So now the Lord's going to the third one, the devil. He says to the serpent, because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle and above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life.
Amen.
And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Praise God, yes.
Amen.
Satan, I'm putting the curse on you.
Yes.
That's what the Lord said.
Yes.
I'm going to lift the curse off humanity.
Yeah.
But I'm putting a curse on you.
That's right.
Now it's going to take some time to get this curse lifted off.
Amen.
And it took a whole lot of stuff. God had to kill an animal, a blood sacrifice to clothe Adam and Eve to get them through that period of time.
Yeah.
We know that they were told to bring blood sacrifices and altar to worship because Abel knew to do that, but Cain refused to do it. He ate of the curse of the ground. We understand that throughout time when Abraham received the covenant with God, God told him the covenant of the circumcision, told him to take Isaac even up on top of a mountain and offer him on an altar for a sacrifice for sin. Yet God never required him to take his son's life because God was already going to lay his Isaac down. He was already going to give Jesus Christ to be laid on the cross to reverse the curse of sin and the sin of spring. Can you say
amen?
I'm glad I got three sons. Redemption in my soul. Praise the Lord. I'm glad that the Lord didn't require me to purchase salvation because I could have never got enough cash to do it. I'm glad he didn't require us to climb Mount Everest to the top and stick a flag upon the mountain that we might get saved. But instead he just said, repent of your sins, call upon the name of the Lord, and you shall be saved. It's time to reverse the curse.
Yes. Amen.
So Satan comes against the church.
Yep.
He comes against every believer.
Yep.
He comes against your family.
Yep.
He'll come against your finances.
Yep.
He'll come against your physical body. He'll come against your mind. He'll try to fight us on every hand.
Yep.
He is the liar, and the truth isn't in him. He's
Amen.
A liar from the very beginning.
Yes.
God God always put a blessing on your life. Hallelujah. You are blessed and highly favored of the Lord.
Glory.
Amen. Someone said, I don't know how Billy Graham lived to be 99. I do. The strength of the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
Someone said, I don't know how Charles Begley's still going 82. I do. He's got the strength of the Lord. Someone said, I'm not so sure. Look, we have no promise of tomorrow. So you're here today and you're gone tomorrow. Job said, listen, I know my Redeemer liveth. He said, yea, though the skin worms should devour this body of mine, yet in my flesh I'm going to see the Lord. He said, man is born of woman a few days and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth as a shadow and continueth not. James said, life is like a vapor on the water. It appeareth for a little while and it vanishes away. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Even Job said, the Lord has set a boundary out there that I say you cannot pass. Yet the Bible says you can either lengthen or shorten your days by your obedience. And if you honor your father and your mother, your days shall be long upon the earth.
Amen. Amen.
So there's some promises in the word. You can accept the blessing or you can live under the curse.
Amen.
I've decided to live under the blessing. Amen.
Yay, glory.
I decided to go around saying, I am blessed and highly favored. Fred and Skill, love to do that every day. How you doing, Fred? I am blessed and highly favored.
Yes, amen.
And Vernon's got another one. I'll say, how you doing? He says, I'm working on awesome. We'll keep working. Because, and how are we awesome? Through Christ. Because it's not I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in us. Amen?
Amen, amen.
But the curse of sin was put upon humanity to try to destroy us. Satan hates God's creation. He tries to bring division. He tries to bring plagues. He tries to bring tragedies. He tries to kill our seed. And he said that he would put enmity, the Lord said, between thee, the seed of the serpent, and the seed of the woman. Now, first of all, a woman doesn't have seed. The man has seed. So when in this prophecy, in Genesis 3:15, we see a prophetic word being spoken. God says to the serpent, I'm going to put enmity between your seed and the seed of the woman. But the woman doesn't have seed. This is why it should have been our first clue that a virgin would conceive.
Praise God.
Of the Holy Ghost.
Yay.
She would not know man and would not have a man's seed, but would have the seed of God, the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And that Holy Spirit would birth the Messiah. And that would be the one that would reverse the curse.
Praise God.
Praise God. Praise the Lord. No wonder. No wonder whenever they were in, the children of Israel were in Egypt, and they had been slaves for 400 years, which was prophesied to happen. Actually, God told Abraham this in the 15th chapter of Genesis. He told him this during a solar eclipse even. He said, listen, I'm going to bless you. You're going to be the father of many nations. But even to the fourth generation, your children will be taken into bondage, and for 400 years will be slaves in a country that's not theirs. But then I'm going to bring them out with a high hand. I'm going to bless them with great substance. They're coming out of Egypt, and they're not coming out all beat down, but they're coming out blessed. Can you say amen? And that's exactly what he did. But before he did it, when the Pharaoh heard that there was a deliverer in the land, Brother Leonard,
come on.
Then Pharaoh sent word to go kill all the babies under the age of 2. And they slaughtered the innocent children.
Yeah.
They slaughtered them. They spilled their blood all over the land of Egypt.
What are they doing now?
They're slaughtering them right now.
Yeah, they are.
Listen, even just this week, Heidi is so upset. In the state of Washington, they just now, they're waiting for the governor to sign it, Washington State, that they have now decided that a woman can sell her womb.
Wow.
So if she can go and have a child, and if she wants to sell the child, she can sell the child while in the womb. She can abort the child and sell the body parts.
Oh my.
Because they're saying it belongs to her. And so the legislators of both sides there in Washington State have already passed it. It's laying on the governor's desk, and he is expected to sign it. See, there you have to understand, folks, we're in the last days.
Yes.
When they would say evil is good and good is evil. When iniquity abound, the love of many will wax cold, Jesus said. And these are the signs of the last days. I've got news for them. Nobody owns life.
That's right. Amen.
God is the life giver. And so this is an abomination that's been going on since 1973 legally. Now, this week I was in Nashville, Tennessee. The Vice President of the United States came and spoke. I was sitting on the fourth row listening to the Vice President.
Amen.
He stepped up to the podium and said, first of all, I am a Christian.
Praise God.
Yes, yeah. Praise God.
Second of all, he said, I am the Vice President of the United States.
Amen.
And thirdly, I am a Republican, in that order.
Okay. Keep it in order.
Keep it in the right order. I'm a Christian.
Glory to God.
He said, I answer to a higher power.
Yes.
Amen.
Beyond Donald Trump.
Amen.
In other words, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Amen. He began to speak, and he almost preached, and he said, I just want to say, I believe that abortion will be canceled in America in my lifetime.
Yes.
I believe it's going to happen. Well, I thought to myself as I was sitting there thinking, if the Vice President of the United States thinks it's going to happen, believes it's going to happen, then we got a shot that it could happen. Can you say amen?
Yes.
Amen.
But it's going to require a lot of prayer. Now, first of all, they slaughtered the babies in Egypt, trying to kill Moses, trying to kill the seed, lest the seed rise up and take the children of Israel out of Egypt. But Satan failed. So then, and you can hear it. The Bible says that when Christ was born, King Herod put a decree to kill all the babies in the land. Under the age of two, the same thing that Pharaoh tried. Trying to kill the seed of God.
Amen.
But the Lord had already come to Joseph in a dream and said, get your wife and the baby and go into Egypt a little while. Praise the Lord. Aren't you glad we're being led by the Spirit of the Lord? That's why it's important to know the Holy Ghost. That's why it's important to pray and to fast and to believe God. And when He speaks to you, move in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
And so, but the Bible even says that Rachel could be heard weeping for her children in the land. And when you go, whenever I went to Bethlehem, I didn't even know this. I've been to the Church of Nativity about three times. I didn't know this. But when Sister Heidi was with me, Sister Heidi, of course, has that prayer group, Rachel's Heart. And she wanted to go to Rachel's tomb. But Rachel's tomb was in the West Bank, in a kind of not a very easy place to get to. It's under a lot of walls and barbed wire and stuff. It gets attacked. That one site does get a little bit of attacks every now and then. It's not easy, but she said, I want to go. So we went.
Amen.
And we went in there, you can go see the tomb of Rachel. And all the prayers that goes on, and there's people praying day and night, 24 hours a day. They just keep praying. Rama can be heard weeping for her children. They just keep praying.
Amen.
But we left Rachel's tomb and went to Bethlehem to the Church of Nativity. And we went in there and got one of the guys, I hired a guy to show us around and kind of cut through the lines a little quicker. And he said, would you like to go down in the dungeon? I said, down in the dungeon? He said, yeah, down in the dungeon. So what's down there? He said, the babies that Herod killed.
Oh my.
I said, are you serious? So the church, the place where Christ was born, the children that were slaughtered during that time were buried. And that very spot is where they built the church of Nativity, of the birth of Christ. So it was a way of God saying, I'm reversing the curse.
Amen.
It's another way of saying, my seed will bruise your head.
Yes.
It may bruise my heel.
Yes.
And when David killed the giant, the Bible tells us that he gave the high priest Antipa. He gave him the sword of Goliath. And the high priest wrapped it in an ephod. And then he took the garment of Goliath and he put it in his own tent. But the head of the giant, David, went 20 miles out of his way. Instead of going to Hebron, where the children of Israel were encamped, he went through the enemy lines to Jerusalem and buried the head of Goliath in the foot of a place called the place of the skull, or or also Amen. Known as Golgotha yes. or Goliath of Gath. Now that head represents the giant or the Nephilim, if you will, the seed of Satan. And when Christ went to the cross, they bruised his heel, but he was standing over the head of the giant. Crushing the head. So you have a situation developing. The seed of God cannot be defeated. But now the devil said, okay, tried to kill the children of Israel in Egypt, he failed. He tried to kill Jesus Christ, he failed. He then tried to stop Israel from becoming a nation. He knew that the Bible plainly said in Ezekiel 37:21 that the Lord said, I will bring them from all the parts of the world and make them a nation in one day.
Praise God.
He knew this prophecy by Ezekiel. He knew what Zechariah's prophecy said about the cup of trembling in Jerusalem.
Amen.
He knew about the prophecy of the prophetic word of God that God said to Abraham in the 12th chapter, I will bless you. You'll be the father of many nations. And he said, I will bless thee. And I will bless them to bless thee and curse them to curse thee. And your name will be, and all the world will be blessed. And so he knew, Satan knew the prophecy that Christ said when he was was in Jerusalem, when he said, why ye men of Galilee, why stand ye here gazing in the heavens? This same Jesus that you see going away is coming back again in like manner. He knew the prophecy of Zechariah and in the 14th chapter when it says that the Lord will descend and stand upon the Mount of Olives and split it in half. He knew the prophecy.
Amen.
And he had to try to stop it again.
Amen.
So he tried to, the Holocaust, he tried to destroy the seed. Because
right.
if he could wipe out every Jew, as far as Lucifer was concerned, he could stop the rebirth of Israel as a nation,
right.
prevent Christ from returning, and save himself from the destiny he has.
Right.
And he has a destiny. The Bible says in the book of Jude that the angels have been reserved in the outer darkness, the chains of iron of darkness. That Jesus said in his prophecies in Revelation that Satan will be thrown into the lake of fire with the beast and the false prophet and tormented day and night, the Bible says.
Yay, hallelujah.
And so he's trying to prevent the return of Christ. And though the Holocaust happened, though there was millions killed, there was a remnant of the seed that made it out of there alive and have been brought back from every nation. And in 1948, Israel became a nation. Can you say it? And get this, from Abraham's covenant until Jesus Christ was 1948 years. From the birth of Christ to the rebirth of Israel as a nation, 1948 years. From the destruction of the temple in 70 AD to today, 1948 years.
Praise God.
So it just shows you you're living in the end times.
Yes.
You don't know the day nor the hour. The Lord's coming. But I think we're getting in the team picture, okay? I think we're in the team picture, maybe. Anyway, we know the Lord's coming back.
Yeah, he is.
The verb, reversing the curse.
Yes.
When Christ went to the cross, he took the sins of many. He bore the sins of us all. And the iniquity of him was laid upon him. And the government was upon his shoulder. And there between the heavens and the earth, they had to get two false witnesses to even condemn him. They tried all day. They couldn't get two people to agree. They had to hire him to false witness against him. And so at the end, Pilate's wife came in and said, don't have anything to do with this just man. I have suffered all night in dreams. And Pilate washed his hands in the water and tried to rid himself of the responsibility and turned and walked out onto the stage, had Jesus beaten with 39 lashes and paraded around in a purple robe. A crown was on his head of thorns. And Pilate asked the people, he said, who should I release unto you, Jesus of Nazareth or Barabbas? And they cried, give us Barabbas. And away with Jesus. And in some way, every one of us have said that in our life.
That's right.
That's why we need to be saved.
Yes.
Because we couldn't save ourselves.
No.
The only way the curse can be reversed is through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
But finally, in closing, when Christ died on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And he gave up the ghost. You know, even saved a man next to him. He forgave everybody. And he gave up the ghost. And the Bible said the sky became black.
Yeah.
And an earthquake hit Jerusalem and tore the veil in the temple in half. And the scriptures tell us that they begged the body of Christ off the cross because it was almost the beginning of the Passover. And they hurried him down and buried him in Joseph Arimathea's new tomb. And there he was buried among the rich because there was no sin in him. And that's prophecy in Isaiah. And as he laid there for 3 days, he was conquering death, sin, sickness, poverty, spiritual damnation. He was breaking the chains. He was reversing the curse.
Praise God.
Going to blow your mind, but it was the Passover. So at the same time they were nailing Christ to the cross, the high priests were over on Mount Moriah binding the lamb to the brazen altar.
Yeah.
The same time.
Wow.
In other words, they were doing what they were supposed to do, but God was sending a remedy. God was sending his only begotten Son to truly break the curse of sin, not just to hold it over a little while. You know, did you ever have a good meal? That'll really fill you up. Did you ever have a snack and mama say, that'll hold you for a while. That'll hold you over.
Yeah.
Amen.
Holding over is okay.
No.
But a good meal's better.
Amen.
Right.
Yes.
So if you're here today or you're watching on the internet or you're not saved, thing to do is ask yourself, are you living in the blessing or are you living in the curse? You don't have to. Christ already paid the price.
Amen.
On the third day, he rose from the grave.
God.
And when he rose, he reversed the curse.
Yes, hallelujah.
He poured out the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost so that the church could have the supernatural power of God.
Hallelujah, glory.
He let us have the washing of the water of the Word. He said, be born of the water and of the Spirit of God. He gave us a plan that was so perfect. It's real simple, really. It says, listen, even a wayfaring man wouldn't err therein. And the Bible tells us, except you become as humble as a little child, you can no wise see the kingdom of God. So what do I got to do, Pastor Begley? Believe, repent, and receive the Lord as your Savior.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to stand all over the building. The preachers will come forward. Ask Brother Leonard to do that. Stand out front. And if you would like to come and get saved, I'll tell you what, this is the day to do it.